The following presentation is brought to you by Discovery Education, leading the world of digital and video learning. Discovery Education, connect to a world of learning.
Gravel, a much underappreciated rock, if you ask me. Now, I wouldn't know this firsthand, of course, but it's often the commonplace item that goes unnoticed. Widely used in roadways, concrete production, and landscaping, gravel is the plain Jane of geology. If you haven't guessed by now, today we're talking materials. Look around, because we're piled high with the stuff that stuff is made of. We begin with two of the most common building blocks of society. We record history on one and build cities with the other. Paper and concrete. Then we hit the road with rubber, steel, and glass. Next, we check out materials of the modern age. Plastics and fibers. Finally, we look at an emerging technology that will help us make new materials one molecule at a time. Grab your hard hat, because we're leaving no stone unturned as we explore our material world. It's so obvious and commonplace that you probably don't even think about it. But just about everything you see, own, make, and buy is made out of something, some material. There are many types of materials, and they come in different varieties. Metals include iron, steel, aluminum, titanium, silver, gold, platinum, bronze, and copper, just to name a few. Each has its disadvantages and advantages. Glass is great for windows, but you wouldn't use it to build a crane. Steel is perfect for building cranes, but not so useful for making windows. Some materials exist in nature, and they were the first things early humans used to make tools and build homes. Over time, humans discovered new materials and created some of our own, often with some amazing properties. We continue to develop new materials all the time, even as we improve existing ones. Now we can even manipulate individual layers of molecules of a material. To learn more about them, you could read a book, which is printed on a material, and we call it paper. The average American uses 650 pounds of it every year. We read it, write on it, eat off it, and even make money out of it. It's paper! The raw material of common paper is wood. Paper begins as a pulp of wood fibers and water. Pulp can be produced chemically by pressure cooking in sodium hydroxide and sodium sulfide. The result is a thin mixture called slurry that is filtered through a mesh screen to form a long, wide, fibrous sheet. Excess water is drained, and the sheet is fed through rollers where it is pressed and dried. Finally, the finished product is formed and can be cut into smaller sheets. Though most paper comes from wood, it gets its name from its earliest raw material, the papyrus plant. Paper's first known use was in ancient Egypt. Papyrus grows as a reed with a stalk about 10 feet tall. The Egyptians cut the inner part of the stalk into strips, which they soaked and arranged at right angles in a flat sheet. They pounded it to fuse the plant fibers and then placed heavy weights to force out the air and water and reduce the thickness. They left the sheets to dry in the air. The Egyptians recorded on papyrus much of what we know today about the building of the pyramids, tomb construction, and other ancient practices. In the first century AD, the Chinese developed a process that created a smooth, thin material, ideal for writing. Villagers in Xinhua, China, still make paper the traditional way, that is, sheet by sheet. Workers harvest bamboo that grows in abundance on the mountainside. Then they dry it and chop it into chips. They steam the chips to make them moist and crumbly. Then they soak them in lime and grind them into a thick stew. Once it turns white, they grind it again into liquid pulp that is perfect for use as paper. After the workers suspend the pulp in a vat of water, they gather a thin layer in a screen and then lay it out to drain with one sweeping, elegant motion. Members of this family have been making paper for 14 generations, over nearly 300 years. The technique takes a long time to master. Though most paper in the world is produced in large factories using costly equipment, the process is similar to ancient practices. The many varieties of paper require different volumes or densities of pulp and different lengths of wood fiber. Compare tissue paper to computer paper, or wrapping paper to wallpaper, or a paper bag to a cardboard box. One of the most widespread uses of paper is money. Paper for United States currency is not made of wood. It is made of a combination of 75% cotton and 25% linen. Tiny red and blue synthetic fibers are randomly added to prevent counterfeiting. When the printing machines roll, 8,000 sheets of money representing 256,000 bills can be cranked out every hour. Paper has unlimited uses. No matter what form it takes, it's one material that makes many modern conveniences possible.
Have you ever stopped to think how amazing paper is? It's thin, lightweight, and it can absorb ink. It's inexpensive and recyclable too. But if you need something more permanent, you may want to consider concrete. It's useless for printing books, but it works magnificently for building highways, bridges, airports, and libraries.
Concrete is virtually everywhere. In buildings, tunnels, highways, parking lots, even in wacky roadside attractions. Though the terms concrete and cement are sometimes used to mean the same thing, concrete is actually a mixture of cement, sand, and gravel, which hardens when water is added. Sounds simple, but it took centuries for concrete to become what it is today. A form of concrete first surfaced around 2500 BC when Egyptians were experimenting with ways to make brick stick together. They used combinations of mud and straw, as well as gypsum and lime, to secure the bricks and stones of the pyramids and other great structures. The Romans also recognized the usefulness of concrete. They discovered that by adding volcanic ash to lime and water, the material became much stronger and waterproof. Much of the ancient empire, including the Appian Way and the Colosseum, contain Roman concrete. After the fall of the Roman Empire, the quality of the material deteriorated until an engineer named John Smeaton decided to do as the Romans did, by combining lime and water. Smeaton was commissioned in 1756 to rebuild Eddystone Lighthouse in England, which was an impossible task without a water-resistant building material. He heated limestone containing clay and produced hydraulic lime, which hardened underwater. This advancement led to the 1824 invention of Portland cement, named for its resemblance to the building stone quarried on the Isle of Portland in England.
It was a huge success, and it is found in almost all modern-day concrete. The next step was to reinforce it with metal. Concrete itself isn't very strong when tension is applied, but adding metal counteracts this weakness. The first reinforced concrete appeared in 1849 in the form of an iron mesh inserted into flower pots. Reinforced concrete was versatile and can be used in many structures like railroad ties, pipes, and bridges. About 40 years after the introduction of this idea, the first reinforced concrete bridge was constructed in America. The Lake Alford Bridge in San Francisco, California, contains square steel bars to support its 64-foot concrete arch. The added strength of the bridge helped it withstand the 1906 San Francisco earthquake. Today, reinforced concrete is used in structures that support more weight than the Lake Alford Bridge. A prime example is the 844-foot tall Hyatt Park Tower in Chicago, Illinois.
Start the pump, Greg. Start the pump.
The hotel's framework requires tons of concrete, which workers pump between movable steel walls. Miles of rebar, or steel reinforcement bar, reinforce the concrete to make it strong and resilient. From the pyramids of ancient Egypt to modern-day skyscrapers, concrete has been an essential building material. One of our most versatile materials is glass. It keeps the rain out of our homes and can be turned into lenses that help us see far away and extremely close up. Let's take a closer look. You can see through it or look at yourself in it. It can be functional or decorative, clear or colored. Introducing glass. Glass is the combination of purified sand, cullet, which is the crushed remains of pure crystal glass, and other optional chemical ingredients that are used to add color or sparkle to glass. All of these elements are combined by fire, creating 2,500 degree Fahrenheit molten glass that flows into molds for pressing or blowing. Historians believe glassmaking began around 2500 BC, when the Egyptians first made glass beads. Glass blowing, however, dates back to the first century BC. The technique used to blow glass has remained pretty much the same. The Romans were among the first to use molds to make glass objects. Rather than shape the melted glass by hand, they developed this clever innovation to produce pieces more quickly. Today, machinery helps the molding process. First, the molten glass is poured into the mold. The runoff, cooled with water, becomes cullet that will be reused. This is where the talent and craftsmanship of glassblowing comes in. The molten glass, now cooled to 1500 degrees Fahrenheit, is attached to a blowing rod. The rod and glass are heavy, about 35 pounds. A worker rolls the glass to maintain its form. He blows carefully into the rod to create a shape. The glass is reheated to keep it pliable. Next, the glass goes to the gaffer, the master glass worker in charge. The gaffer sculpts and reshapes the glass. After measuring and adding final cuts, he finishes the piece. Decorative and functional glass objects are cut on a diamond wheel. Then workers polish them to restore the natural brilliance of the glass. Sometimes glass pieces are engraved. There are many ways to create designs once the glass has been shaped. One of the most popular methods is called copper wheel engraving, in which designs are cut into the glass with spinning copper discs. Finally, glassmakers examine the objects for imperfections. If they are not satisfied, they may keep only the best pieces and reuse the rest as cullet. As early as the first century BC,
Window panes and other flat pieces were made by spinning a balloon of molten glass. This usually produced small pieces that showed where the rod had been attached. In the 11th century, glassblowers discovered that they could make cylinders, cut them open, and flatten them out to make flat sheets of glass. Today, rolled plates are used for this purpose. Glassmaking is also a fine art. Dale Chihuly is one of the world's foremost glass artists. He lives in Seattle, Washington. Chihuly became interested in glassblowing in the 1960s. He traveled to the small island of Murano, Italy, where glassblowing was a popular trade. One of the most important lessons Chihuly learned there was that the craft requires teamwork.
In the shop here, we usually work with a team, and they work on two benches. And it starts with some color that we get onto the pipe, and then you gather up glass out of the furnace. Depending on how large the piece is, you may have up to 6 or 8 gathers of glass. Colored glass can be added onto those gathers by wrapping it around the piece, what we call a body wrap. And then you hand it to the master glass blower, and he blows it up a little bit more. Eventually, when he gets it the way he wants it, he transfers it over to a solid rod called a punty. It's heated up in the glory hole, it's prepared in a certain way. There's a lip wrap that goes around the top when the hole is still quite small. And then it's heated up and spun open. And it's this centrifugal force of the spinning of the molten glass out. And it's gravity when you hang it down that makes the shape. This is really what the part of it that I probably, as an artist, develop more, and my claim to fame in glass blowing would be working with it, with the heat and the fire and the gravity.
Dale Chihuly's permanent exhibit in Tacoma, Washington, helped him make the city an international glass-blowing center. Glass has many functions and is tested, modified, and treated for even more uses. Inventor Catherine Blodgett created non-reflective glass in 1938. She discovered a method to apply thin film coatings to eyeglass lenses to reduce glare and protect eyes. Her invention is used today in microscopes, telescopes, and camera lenses. Glass has also been modified for our safety. Ballistic glass can stop a bullet fired from an automatic rifle. It is made of multiple layers of glass bonded with strong, transparent plastic. The layers absorb the force of the speeding bullet. The plastic layers keep the glass layers intact so they can stop the bullet. The outer layers of plastic catch glass fragments. It is ancient, but glass has new applications in cutting-edge technology. Glass optical fibers are the thread of cable television and the internet. They carry digital signals of light over vast distances. Glass, in its many forms, is all around us. Its elemental beauty and clarity has appealed to humans throughout the ages and has inspired artisans and scientists to create new forms and uses for all to enjoy.
Steel was a powerful resource for the industrial age, and it's one of the most popular building materials today. It's strong and relatively light, making it possible for us to build taller buildings, stronger railroad tracks, safer cars, and more durable machinery. Let's see how it all began.
Steel is a building block of modern life. It's used to produce buildings, cars, trains, appliances, and even artificial body parts. Steel is an iron alloy. That means iron has been mixed with carbon and other elements like nickel and chromium to make it lighter, stronger, and more versatile. Similar alloys include cast iron, which has a high carbon content, and wrought iron, which has little or no carbon. Since the time of the ancient Egyptians, people have made objects out of iron. The process for creating steel developed in India and China as early as 300 BC. Between the 12th and 16th centuries, the Japanese samurai used a special technique to create swords that were both sharp and resilient. Their secret was to combine steels of different hardnesses. Japanese swordsmiths began by making an extremely hard steel, controlling the carbon content through hammering. When the carbon level was right, they folded the steel and hammered it. Each fold doubled the number of layers. They used this hard steel for the sharp cutting edge. Their swordsmiths also made a soft steel with a lower carbon content. When the two steels were joined, the softer metal in the middle became a flexible core. After the hard and soft steels were combined, the swordsmiths reheated them and drew them out into a single long blade. The temperature of the blade had to be greater than 1500 degrees Fahrenheit. A swordsmith judged the temperature of the steel by its color as he heated it in a forge. Samurai swords, with their combination of flexibility and sharpness, are still considered superior to all other swords. Japanese knowledge of steel making helped make the samurai both feared and famous. Today, the process of making steel begins with a mixture of iron ore, industrial lime, which is a calcium oxide, and coke, or baked coal. Here at the U.S. steel plant, a railroad car dumps the mixture into a blast furnace where hot air brings it to about 3,300 degrees Fahrenheit. In a process called smelting, the liquid iron is combined with carbon and other elements to transform it into different kinds of steel. The combination of elements controls the hardness, stretch, and strength of the steel. Then the liquid steel is poured into molds, cooled and cut into long slabs. From here, the slabs are sent to another factory where they are heated again and wound into long coils called hot bands. Finally, the steel is ready to be shipped to the customer and crafted for its desired use. Steel was first used as a building material in the 1850s because traditional building materials, stone, brick, and wood, had major limitations. Stone structures, for example, had to support their own weight in addition to the rest of the structure, making it hard for a building to be more than 5 stories tall. Then in 1856, Henry Bessemer introduced his Bessemer steel converter in Sheffield, England. He used it to mass-produce steel, making 30 tons of high-grade steel in half an hour. Because steel is several times stronger than stone and much lighter, engineers could make taller, sturdier building skeletons. Andrew Carnegie opened the first fully integrated steel plant in the United States in 1875. After making his fortune in railroads and oil, Carnegie realized he could make more money with steel. In 1901, he launched U.S. Steel with the help of Charles Schwab, J.P. Morgan, and Elbert Gerry. The company remains the largest producer of steel in America today. Steel produced in this factory is shipped on rail cars bound for destinations across the nation. More than 58,000 tons of steel went into the construction of the 102-story Empire State Building. Steel also helped supply America with weapons and planes during World War II. Another variation of steel was invented in the early 1900s. The addition of chromium produced the stainless steel used to make appliances, automobiles, utensils, and other everyday tools. Stainless steel has a higher resistance to rust and corrosion than ordinary steel, which makes it a desirable material for airplanes, operating rooms, and kitchens. The importance of steel in our world, past, present, and future, cannot be denied. Its strength and durability helped build civilization as we know it. Another useful material used in items like tires and wetsuits is rubber. It's a natural resource with a buoyant nature. These qualities of rubber, elasticity, resilience, and toughness, make it a common element in shoes, house paint, tires, and many other everyday items. Natural rubber comes from trees in the tropical areas of South America and Asia. Latex, a milky white liquid in rubber, is collected from the bark. Solid rubber forms when the latex is heated and chemicals are added. Then the rubber is firmly pressed to remove moisture and formed into sheets or blocks for shipping. The inventor Charles Goodyear discovered rubber gets stronger when it is heated with sulfur at high temperatures. This became known as the vulcanization process in 1839. As the demand for rubber increased, so did its price. Attempting to create a less costly synthetic rubber, scientists discovered polymerization. This process allows chemical compounds to link as long-chain molecules. Synthetic rubber can withstand harsh conditions, so it's the most commonly used material in tires for cars, trucks, and airplanes. Named after the inventor, Goodyear Tire and Rubber Company sells more than 225 million tires a year to consumers and car makers. Tires need to work well on the worst roads and in bad weather. Each new tire design is tested extensively. The creation of a tire begins with a blend of rubber, oil, carbon black, and pigments. Strength and durability come from specialized liners, fabrics, rubber-coated steel cables, and steel belts applied around a tire-shaped mold called a building drum. These giant donuts are called green tires because they're not yet cured. They are placed in a mold that gives them their tread. Intense temperatures and pressure create a tough, vulcanized tire that doesn't melt in heat or crack in cold, but provides a flexible cover that holds compressed air. This type of tire is called a pneumatic tire. In 1888, an Irish veterinarian named John Boyd Dunlop invented the pneumatic tire after he noticed that his son's tricycle wheels were treaded with solid rubber, making for a bumpy ride. Hoping to correct the problem, he devised a crude wheel surrounded by a rubber tire inflated with air. Dunlop's tires consisted of canvas strips bound or nailed around the outside of a wooden rim. The inner tube was vulcanized. Soon after, two French brothers, André and Edouard Michelin, invented a tire with a tube that could be detached. They were the first to fit pneumatic tires to an automobile. The rubber tread is designed to resist wear and tear from contact with the road, including protection from punctures and loss of air. In the early days of tire production, craftsmen known as tire builders made the tires. The same methods are used today at Dunlop's facility at Birmingham, England. Albert Thord is one of the last surviving tire builders.
It's very important that the skills are passed on, because these type of cars have been going around for that many years now that they will be going on for many years to come.
Even with a growing number of materials that can withstand severe conditions and serve many functions, rubber has always bounced to the top of the list for versatility, resilience, and durability.
Plastics. They come in many types and take many forms, each with its own advantages. Styrofoam is lightweight and known for its heat-insulating qualities. Polyvinyl chloride, or PVC, is stiff, strong, and waterproof. Polytetrafluoroethylene, or Teflon, works as a low-friction, scratch-resistant surface coating. Plastics, as we shall see, serve us in many ways.
Welcome to the wonderful world of plastic. We have it all, in every shape, size, and color you can imagine. Toys, kitchenware, clothing, and even devices that will help save lives. Just what is plastic? It's a synthetic material made of polymers, or long chains of molecules. John Hyatt, an amateur chemist, invented plastic in the 1860s. He used the long stringy molecules of cellulose found naturally in plants to create celluloid. Then in 1909, Leo Baekeland took the invention a step further and made a polymer that he called Bakelite. Bakelite is made from two molecules derived from coal. Bakelite cannot burn, melt, or conduct electricity. These characteristics made it a strong and durable material with insulating properties. After the invention of Bakelite, people found uses for plastics almost everywhere.
The plastic body on this vehicle is made of the same kind of plastic you use in the pop bottles that you pick up.
Plastic has been used to create synthetic fabrics since 1931. The fashion industry continues to rely on the evolution of synthetics. In fact, plastic fabrics can now be melted together. No more sewing. Plastic is also a useful material in the medical field, saving lives and easing suffering.
If there wasn't any plastic, I think we'd have a hard time with an awful lot of medicine. We wouldn't have artificial hips, we wouldn't have contact lenses, we wouldn't even have syringes.
We owe much of our safety to plastic. National defense depends on plastic to make planes faster and lighter, yet incredibly strong. Plastic is also used in bulletproof vests and protective headgear.
In our ballistic vests and our ballistic helmets, there's a material called Kevlar that we use to help keep us safe. It makes these helmets and these vests bullet resistant.
And of course, there is the entertainment value of plastic. Since it is cheap and can be made durable, pliable, and in a rainbow of colors, plastic makes up countless toys. Plastic's durability is also its downfall. Because many plastic materials are made to last forever, plastics pile up in landfills.
There's a lot of problems with recycling. The way our products are made now, we're not able to turn a certain plastic back into the same exact kind of product. Inherently, it's just not an elegant solution to create something that we have to decompose.
So researchers are developing an eco-friendly plastic called polylactic acid, or PLA. Most plastic is made from petroleum, but PLA is made from corn. This type can decompose if it's treated properly when discarded. Maurice Ward, a British businessman, has attempted to create a new type of plastic with special properties. He calls it Starlight Polymer and claims it can withstand temperatures up to 10,000 degrees Celsius, equivalent to the heat created by an atomic explosion. Ward revealed his new plastic on television with this simple but effective egg test. Unprotected, the egg cooked and cracked in seconds. But when coated with Starlight, there were different results.
That looks nice and red. As though it's hot. But if you take the torch away and put my fingers on there, it's absolutely cold. I will now take the egg there and crack it open.
A tragedy led Ward to invent Starlight. After a plane caught fire taking off from Manchester Airport in 1985, he committed himself to creating a new fire retardant. Surprisingly, it took him only a few months of blending compounds to create the Starlight polymer. Britain's Ministry of Defense developed further tests and established that Starlight is in fact a very good fire and thermal barrier that also offers protection against radiation. While the ministry is looking into space and military applications for Starlight, Ward is most interested in developing it for families to use at home. Plastic is one of the most useful materials in existence, and it continues to affect how we work, play, heal, and communicate. It may sound uncomfortable to wear plastic. Imagine a shirt made of garbage bags. But some plastics, spun and stretched into fibers, can be turned into fabrics that are perfectly suitable. An Animals have fur, feathers, scales, or thick skin to protect them from the environment. But humans require a supplemental external covering. Early humans used animal skins and later fabrics made from wool, cotton, and other natural materials. But in the 20th century, scientists invented new artificial fibers. These materials do not come directly from plants or animals. In the 1930s, Wallace Carruthers led a team of DuPont scientists to create the first completely synthetic fiber, nylon. Nylon is a polymer, a large molecule with repeating chemical structures that form a chain. These string-like molecules take on a variety of shapes. Some types of nylon can be stretched to several times their original length. Nylon's development began in April 1930 when a lab assistant on Carruthers' team produced a strong polymer that could be pulled into a fiber. Unfortunately, this substance melted at a very low temperature. Carruthers continued the research and in 1935 developed nylon, which stood up well to heat and solvents. Nylon had many immediate applications, including parachutes, monofilament fishing line, and of course, stockings. In the decades that followed, scientists developed many more synthetic fibers, including one that was used to make outfits like this. Polyester became fashionable in the 1970s, but British scientists had invented it during World War II. At the time, the manufacturing process for the formula was too complicated and expensive for mass production. In the early 1960s, Delbert Meyer, a chemist with Amoco Chemical Company, revolutionized polyester production by eliminating the lengthiest steps in the purification of terephthalic acid, the basic ingredient of polyester. Meyer's process is used in more than half the polyester produced in the world. That's more than 26 billion pounds each year. He received the National Medal of Technology for his invention in 1992. Nylon and polyester are two of the most commonly used synthetic fibers in clothing and other fabrics. Stephanie Qualick invented a fiber you're not likely to find in your wardrobe unless it includes a bulletproof vest. Stephanie Qualick, a chemist, patented an invention in 1974 that became one of the most significant synthetic fibers in the modern world. It's called Kevlar, and today it has a wide variety of uses. Qualick grew up in New Kensington, Pennsylvania, and graduated from the Carnegie Institute of Technology in 1946. She took a job with the DuPont Company, a major achievement since very few women were working as research chemists at that time. Qualick began working with chemical substances called polymers, or molecules that are long chains of smaller molecules. In 1964, she discovered a new fiber that was surprisingly stiff and strong.
When I took some of this solution on a spatula, you know, and held it up in order to determine whether it would flow well enough to be spinnable, I noticed that it was a very cohesive solution and that it's held together very well.
The strength of Kevlar comes from its molecular structure. Natural fibers have a looser, more random pattern, while polymers can blend in a tighter, more uniform, linear structure. This makes them stronger. Kevlar is spun by forcing liquid polymer through tiny openings, then pulling it through cold water, where the liquid hardens into fibers. Afterwards, a heat-treating process increases the stiffness of the fiber. Although Qualick and her colleagues did not know of a market for Kevlar, they set out to find its applications after DuPont invested in a manufacturing plant. They found many. Kevlar is 5 times stronger than steel, lighter than fiberglass, and heat-resistant, so it's a material that can be used in hundreds of products. It makes canoes and kayaks stronger but lighter, It goes into tires and bridges, and it's an important safety material in flame retardant clothing and bulletproof vests. Stephanie Qualick obtained many other patents for polymers and polymer manufacturing in her years as a research scientist. In 1994, she became the fourth woman to be inducted into the National Inventors Hall of Fame. Composites are a combination of different materials blended into a single structure. One of the most widely used is carbon fiber. Planes, cars, boats, and bikes are made in part of composites. A composite is a combination of materials that is better than any of the materials by themselves. Composite materials made with carbon fiber are stiff, light, and durable. Their strength and low weight make them highly sought after. A revolution in materials took place in the 1950s when the United States Space Program increased its demand for lightweight and heat-stable materials. To help the space industry find a cost-effective and lightweight solution, scientists developed many types of composites, including carbon fiber. The automotive industry began experimenting with carbon fiber to help make cars lighter. The less a car weighs, the less fuel it needs. And less fuel means less pollution.
First of all, weight is very important. Our goal for cars in the year of 2020 is to take about 40% of the weight out of a vehicle. And that's a huge challenge. It will take a complete rethink of really the entire vehicle structure.
One manufacturer set out to see how much a car's weight could be reduced. The result was an ultralight car. The ultralight weighs less than 1,400 pounds, half the weight of the smallest European car. Its body, made from the same carbon fiber in racing bikes, skis, and tennis rackets, weighs less than 420 pounds. Composites also helped to create a revolution in bicycle manufacturing with carbon fiber in frames and wheels.
This is carbon fiber. It's multiple plies of carbon fiber laid down in a sheet that then we cut with a special knife system that's on the CNC cutting table. We would never want to make all of the pieces parts all the same thickness. The bike would be way too heavy. So what we are doing is we are structurally reinforcing only those areas that need it, and so therefore lightening the bike up and yet maintaining performance. This is a 2005 Medon frame, and it weighs about the same as a paperback book.
Carbon fiber's lightweight makes it popular among yacht owners too, especially those who race. Today, one of the world's foremost designers of 18-foot skiffs is Julian Bethwaite. He's been working with boats for more than 20 years. He uses a minimalist approach.
The boats of the previous era, it was like getting a car and putting a bigger motor in them. In this scenario, we're using the same motor and making the car more slippery. So the boats now are much more slippery and far cleaner, and they slide through the water much easier with the same sort of horsepower.
The invention of carbon fiber composites has provided durable, ultralight, and heat-resistant materials for boats, planes, cars, and bikes. The increasing demands for fuel conservation and pollution reduction are likely to further advance the uses of composite materials in the future. Inventing isn't just for nuclear physicists and PhDs. You can be an inventions pioneer. Our student inventor Ryan had to choose the materials for his fishing boat carefully. A boat's weight, strength, and buoyancy are largely determined by what it's made of. Ryan loves fishing and boating, so he modeled a 30-foot fishing boat for his student project.
My goal is to design a boat that's meant for temperate waters.
His first step was to come up with an original design.
Most boats are designed for more tropical climates. In tropical regions, they see a lot flatter seas, so they're concerned with high speeds. My goal is to be able to handle rougher seas that you see in more temperate areas. I tried to find areas where I could decrease and increase the angles of the actual V shape of the hull. Here I'm concerned with wider angles, which is going to slightly slower the speeds, but it's also going to create a much more stable ride.
A hull with wide angles increases the boat's surface area in the water. This means greater stability. Once his design was complete, Ryan had to decide on the materials he would use to build the model.
Styrofoam is a good base for the model because it'll float if I need it to. After attaching different layers of styrofoam, I then used this drawing and glued it to the side to trace my design out and cut it. Over this foam core, I laid a layer of marine structural filler. And the surface is slightly rough because it does need more sanding and more filling. It's in the very beginning stages.
Ryan also researched what materials are used in the construction of real boats.
Styrofoam is a base similar to actual boats where they do start out with a foam core. If this boat was actually built to 30-foot scale, I would build it using carbon fiber. This right here, what I'm holding, is a roll of carbon fiber similar to the size that you'd see in an actual boat manufacturing plant. They'd start out with a big metal mold, and inside that mold, they'd lay this fiberglass down and cover it up with a liquid known as fiberglass resin. You take a good piece of cardboard would work, maybe like a putty knife, something like that, and you dip it into your resin. So once you have it piled up, you want to lay down your sheet of fiberglass, start with one end and flatten as you go to the other. This is very important here to avoid bubbling. And you'll notice as I'm flattening it out, it starts to get saturated and it begins to soak in. So after this, the next step will be to actually let it sit. You can apply your next layer once it becomes hard. And in between layers, it's good to do a small amount of sanding so that there's a rough surface to adhere to. And once you build up about an inch thick, then you'll actually have your boat hull all built up.
Even though he only has the means to build a model, Ryan's design could be built into a real boat made of carbon fiber.
My goal is actually to end up studying naval architecture in college next year.
Soon, Ryan could be building real boats.
Throughout history, our use of materials has been limited to what's available in the world around us. We can't create something from nothing, but we can manipulate the things we find to create new materials. The field of nanotechnology is taking that manipulation to a whole new level, the atomic level.
What if you could take water and air and make potato starch? Or what if you could take an ordinary piece of coal and turn it into a diamond? These scenarios might be more realistic than you think, thanks to developments in the emerging field of nanotechnology. Still in its infancy, nanotechnology may enable the manufacturing of many products and materials at an elemental level. What this means is that by manipulating atoms, scientists will be able to produce common or even create brand new substances and devices. Nobel Prize winner Richard Feynman first hypothesized in 1959 that products could be created by building them with individual particles, one at a time. He believed that manipulating individual atoms could open the door to a whole new world of technology. Conventional manufacturing uses large quantities of existing materials and then processes them in a variety of ways. Steel is made by mixing iron and carbon atoms. Rayon is made by altering the positions of atoms in cellulose molecules from wood. Ethane and propane molecules removed from petroleum and combined with other molecules make plastics. These products are created by taking a substance and removing components or combining other substances to form something new. Nanotechnology enables bottom-up manufacturing or connecting atoms in a specific way to create a common product or an entirely new substance. Bottom-up manufacturing may produce less waste and less pollution. Laboratories all over the world are researching and developing nanotechnology. One computer company in the United States has created an atomoscope, which allows scientists to view and manipulate individual atoms. A computerized atomoscope uses a conductive metal tip to move atoms. This device is helping to create microscopic computer chips that could make computers smaller, more efficient, and more affordable. This revolutionary technology is not limited to computers. It may pave the way for improvements in medicine, agriculture, and military weaponry. Nanotechnology is often referred to as a general-purpose technology because it has the potential to affect almost all industries by offering better, cleaner, and safer products. In turn, these products should be inexpensive to produce because the only required building material will be atoms. With improvement in nanotechnology, it's not unrealistic that people might be able to make use of this technology themselves. So people will be able to create their own fabrics, food, fuel, and computers. Nanotechnology may begin another industrial revolution, one that completely changes all manufacturing as we know it. It's time for Before You Know It, when we step across the cutting edge of technology and glance into the future of invention. We sent students to Wired Magazine's Next Fest in New York City to witness and experience some emerging technologies for themselves. At Next Fest, companies showcase technologies that are transforming our world. Today, we are looking into the future of materials.
What we have made is cardboard furniture. It is totally recycled, totally recyclable, lightweight. You can actually put up project tables in a matter of minutes, stand by and take it up once your project is done. You can paint on it, you can draw on it, you can make collage with it. It's rather inexpensive, it's lightweight, it's made of a honeycomb structure. Because of the way the core holds between the two boards, this material can stand a lot of weight.
We also learned about a quieter, more efficient jet engine that incorporates new materials called composites.
This is a composite fan blade for our GE90 engine, which is a commercial engine that goes on the Boeing 777s. And the unique feature about this blade is that it's made from composite materials, and it's the first composite blade that's ever been put into use on commercial aircraft. I don't know if you know anything about composites and how they work, but composites are all fibers, and there's layer upon layer of the fiber materials, and it's like a fabric where they're woven. It goes layer over layer over layer that they keep building. But the nice thing about these composite materials is the durability. Stronger than metals, which were our traditional materials that we made fan blades from.
Will these new fan blades and the lighter fan cases, will they support bigger planes?
This engine right here actually supports a bigger plane. It supports about a 200 to 300 passenger, but in the future, I think the sky's the limit in terms of what we can do with that.
That concludes this edition of Before You Know It. I'm Bill Nye. It will be time for our next edition, Before You Know It.
Without great inventions and materials, we'd never be able to experience the joys of a monster truck rally. Rubber, glass, steel, plastic, and aluminum put to the ultimate test.
As we find and create better materials, we open the door to greater innovation. Skyscrapers get taller. Electronics get smaller. Cars move faster. Space exploration reaches farther. And with the science of nanotechnology, we may see a whole new generation of extraordinary materials and astonishing inventions. I'm Bill Nye, and thanks for joining me on Greatest Inventions, the Science of Materials. See ya! Tune in next time as we examine inventions that hit really close to home. We'll see how some houses are built in factories and then shipped across the country. We'll learn the basics about paint, plumbing, and air conditioning. Then we'll go to the kitchen and sample something from the freezer. I'm Bill Nye. Join me on the next Greatest Inventions.